You want to listen to a podcast?
By who?
Georgia GOP Congressman Doug Collins.
How is it?
The greatest thing I have ever heard in my whole life.
I could not believe my ears.
In this house, wherever the rules are disregarded, chaos and mob rule. It has been said today, where is bravery? I'll tell you where bravery is found and courage is found. It's found in this minority who has lived through the last year of nothing but rules being broken, people being put down, questions not being answered, and this majority say, be damned with anything else. We're going to impeach and do whatever we want to do. Why? Because we won an election. I guarantee you, one day you'll be back in the minority, and it ain't going to be that fun.
Everybody, you know, Frank, you know, as we were just talking and offline and we were just getting ready to this, Frank Meyers, you know, looking at your resume, one that goes back is, I think, is something that's pretty cool to me. Because I'm, as you probably know and our audience knows, I go complete genre. I go full school. I mean, I started in the 60s with Johnny Cash live at San Quentin. Okay, the only eight track. and so your stuff coming up, tell us a little bit about yourself, though, growing up Ohio native. Talk a little bit about that and then how you got into, you know, really country music. Because, you know, if you look at it, it's like the old, what was the old song? You know, guy from, you know, Chris LeDoux, he shows up, didn't realize he had was it Northern Ohio plates, didn't think he was going to be a country guy. Yeah. How did you get country out of Ohio?
Well, you know, my family is from Kentucky. My dad was from Kentucky. My mother is from, actually, she was born and raised over in East Tennessee. And so really? They moved to Dayton, Ohio during, you know, the big boom, the industrial boom back in the day. And my dad was a champion fiddle player and guitar player and singer. And he had a voice like Jim Reeves. And
oh, wow.
My grandmother was a five-string banjo player in the style of Grandpa Jones, you know, Hammer and Claw. And so I grew up in a musical family. I mean, I heard music totally from when I popped out and until I left home. So I started playing guitar about nine. My dad was, of course, a big country fan. George Jones, Buck Owens, Del Reeves, Jim Reeves, Eddie Arnold, you know, all of that. And my sister was a big Motown fan. So I heard a lot growing up. You know, I remember in first grade watching the Beatles on Ed Sullivan's show.
Oh, there you go.
So you go. I grew up in probably the best musical time you could ever grow up as far as diversity and the stylists and things that were in the music business back then. Everybody was a stylist for the most part, and there was no Pro Tools. There were no computers, you know, helping the singers out back then. You had to be able to sing, and there were a lot of great groups, and then we had the British Invasion on top of that, and Elvis, you know, I loved Elvis. I always dreamed about being his guitar player. Of course, that never worked out, but so again, I started when I was nine. I played a lot of shows when I was about 12, I guess, 11 or 12. There was a place called Memorial Hall in downtown Dayton, Ohio, and I opened a lot of shows back then. They would let me come out and do one or two songs. So, you know, I met George Jones and Tammy Wynette and Porter Wagoner and Dolly Parton and all these great people. And when I was 14, I was actually a guest on the Porter Wagoner TV show here in Nashville.
Porter Wagoner. I sang country name right there. I mean, you get Porter Wagoner in there. I mean, you're going old school. Well, let me ask you, you name drop, you know, like the Beatles, Elvis, those. What about like the other sort of, I guess, the rebels of the day, the Johnny Cash, the Waylon Jennings, the, you know, the outlaw crew, the Kris Kristofferson crew coming up. Did that influence you as well?
Of course, you know, everything influenced me that was good. And some bad for that matter. But, you know, when I was talking about those names, that was before Cash and all of them. I mean, that was 60s, you know, 70s, you know, we had all that music stuff going on. And of course, Johnny Cash and Kristofferson and, you know, Willie really wasn't quite going yet. He didn't happen, I think, till the 80s or late 70s, I guess. Him and Waylon. But no, I was a, you know, I listened to everything just because I grew up with a musical background of everything. So I really liked everything. And I started tending more towards pop a little bit just because of some of the groups and the harmonies and chord progressions and things that they were doing that caught my ear and helped me to become a better musician, eventually a better songwriter, because I didn't move to town as a songwriter.
Yeah, because you was actually playing, you were a performer and everything else. When did you, before we get into a little bit more, when did you actually make the transition to Nashville and that area? Sort of that became, more the base. I know your recording career as well. Did that happen early on as well?
My wife and I moved to Nashville in April of 81.
Okay.
And I started playing lead guitar for a guy named Eddie Raven.
Yep.
In about July of 81. And everything happened really fast. I was very blessed. There's so many people that have come here and just, did the Bluebird and did all these things for years before they ever had a cut. I was blessed to have a cut within 6 months of being here.
Right, right. Yeah, and Eddie Raven, you played a lot with him. You did a lot of his stuff. I Got Mexico, Should Have Been Gone By Now, Sometimes Lady. I mean, just some really, good stuff from that time of the and going on. I mean, I do have a quick question for you, because I've always been fascinated by this. Guitars, I've always been fascinated, though, by the banjo. And you talked about your mom, playing the five-string banjo.
My grandmother.
I have heard, and again, you're just talking about it, you had some who play guitar and say banjo is just so hard to play. And then I've had others who say banjo's easy to play and they don't play guitar. What about you? Did you ever cross over and play both, or did you learn both from your mom, or is that myth sort of true? You either sort of do one or the other.
Well, first of all, it was my grandmother that played. My mom.
Oh, grandmother. Okay.
But yeah. I did end up playing a little five-string banjo and learning Foggy Mountain Breakdown, Cripple Creek, and some things like that. I wasn't a great banjo player. I just did it mainly, when my brother and I had a band up in Dayton, I would pull the banjo out and just do a few songs just for, diversity, more or less. Yep. But I was more of a guitar player. And again, I started playing guitar when I was 9.
Right. So you made that up. Well, a question here comes because you've talked about performing and, being an artist part of the side, and you're bringing, because I've talked to a lot of songwriters who, they do their own songs. They go do songwriter rounds. They go to the Bluebird. They go around the country. But as far as never, they never put us out front, so to speak, as an artist. It was all, it's always part of their part. How is being an artist, and basically because you started, I think, probably more as an artist, and I'm sure writing songs as well. Do you think that influenced you in your writing style? Was it mainly you were writing more for yourself and other people liked it? Talk to us a little bit, for the person out there who likes to perform, but also has that little bit of writing, that has that writing side in them as well.
Well, as I told you, I didn't come to town as a writer. I came as a guitar player, but I had put some melodies to other people's lyrics when I come to town. And getting the job with Eddie, Eddie was such a great and is such a great songwriter. I just wanted to show him a few of the songs that I had put melodies to, and he liked my melodies, and it kind of went from there. We ended up writing together. We went and we opened a show for Tanya Tucker down in New Orleans in October, I guess, of 81, and she had a title that she wanted Eddie to write with her, and it ended up being the three of us writing the song, and it was called Changes, and that became the title cut of her first Arista album when Arista first moved to town. And I, that happened around November, I guess. And during that time, the guy that produced her was David Malloy, who produced Eddie Rabbit. So I met David, and he really loved the song Changes. And he said, "We're going to be cutting Rabbit in a few months. If you got anything, bring it over." I said, "Great, I will." I didn't have anything at the time, but, within the next few months, I ended up writing You and I, and I took that over there, and wasn't written as a duet initially either.
Oh, wow. Well, let's start off there, because that was when sort of your first breakout hit there. That was the one, You and I, and today, folks, on the podcast, we've got a great, and Frank's brought his guitar with us, and he's willing to do a couple of these lyrics. Frank, let's go back to you and I. What sort of got together? I know you met the Eddie Rabbit folks, but how did Crystal, you said it wasn't a duet, if I understood you correctly. How did Crystal Gayle and Eddie Rabbit get together to do this duet that really became a great, great song?
Well, what happened was they recorded the song, and David thought the song was too short, believe it or not.
usually
they say they're too long. And so he ended up taking the first verse of the song and just copying it and making a second verse out of it. And he wanted me to try to write another verse because he took my second verse and took it down and put it as the third verse. So he called me and I tried to write, a second verse, but everything I wrote, he didn't like. So Eddie had asked Crystal Gayle to come and sing background vocals on the song. And that's how it started. She was just going to put some background vocals on it. And while she was in the studio learning the song, that second verse came back around, which was the same as the first. And she started answering it, kind of practicing while they were doing her mic check. And that just hit David. He said, "That's it. That's how we're going to do it." And she said, "What? I'm just warming up." She says, No. We'll let Eddie sing the first verse by himself. And when it comes back around, you answer him." And then that's how it became a duet.
Wow. The song just seems so natural. I mean, you would think that's the way it was written and it was intended for this way the whole time.
Yeah. I believe in divine providence has its hand in everything. And it was just meant to be,
That is amazing. Well, before I let you play a verse or so of that song, just to remind people of that greatness of that song, you've hit it there. One of the things I always try to talk about with my songwriters is in the state of play now is versus the state of play, back in the 80s and 90s, when you're really writing to get on an album, you're really writing to get that track on an album. If you had the number one, that was fantastic. I mean, I got Mexico with Eddie Raven. I mean, those were great, but you were getting paid differently. And, in nowadays, younger writers in the last 15 years don't really have that concept writing for an album cut, so to speak. What was your remembrances of that? I know I've had some songwriters talk about, all of a sudden I got this huge, gigantic check and it was, that one. And that just doesn't happen as much these days.
Unfortunately, it doesn't happen these days because of streaming and everything. And first of all, I want to thank you for being such a big champion of songwriters and all the work that you did on the bill that was passed, 2 years ago, I guess.
Yep.
You were a big proponent and I guess still are a big proponent for songwriters. And I sure appreciate that. And I want to thank you on behalf of all songwriters, but,
thank you. Yeah. It's easy for guys like y'all. Y'all touched me so much. That's for sure.
Well, I was working with Eddie Raven. So we were writing songs and, he would cut just about everything we wrote. So I wasn't really sitting down trying to write for artists. When I wrote and it wasn't with Eddie, I was just trying to write a great song and let it kind of land where it may. Other than a few times that my first writing partner was Steve Dean over at Tom Collins Music. And, Tom produced the Barbara Mandrell, Ronnie Millsap, Steve Warner, Sylvia, some big ones. And by the time I was there, he was just still doing Barbara and Sylvia, I believe. And maybe Steve Warner. So there were a few songs that we specifically tried to write for Barbara.
Right.
That Tom had kind of requested. And so we got a few cuts with her. But nothing, really major. I had a single with her called Crossword Puzzle. And it came out about the time she had that big car accident. And it just killed the single. So, it was still great.
Oh yeah. Well, it makes it, again, as you look at, everything going on, you look at the different fronts. When you first, cause you had the privilege of being on an opportunity, I guess, was to be on like Porter Wagner show, hearing some of your stuff, sort of on a different medium. What was it like hearing your song, such as You and I, being performed by somebody else and then hearing it on the radio? It's always interesting to me how songwriters respond to that.
Well, I specifically remember where we were the very first time I heard You and I on the radio, and my wife and I were driving down West End Avenue and I think we were close to the Parthenon area. And it came on and it just blew me away. I had to pull over and listen to it. You know, it's amazing. I mean, anytime you hear one of your songs on the radio, it doesn't really get old. You know, you're thankful for it. It's just a kind of surreal kind of feeling for you when that happened, you know, to think that this is something that developed in your head, you know, as an idea. And then, you know, you wrote lyrics and you came up with a melody for it. And then the miracle of getting the song cut.
and that was the big thing. Yeah, Aaron Baker and I had a long conversation about that, how you get it on there, and all of a sudden it's there, and then, you know, you're hoping to make it, and then all of a sudden you start getting, you know, enough royalty checks to say, like, hey, I can actually do this. You know, this is going to be a living.
Yeah. You know, the money that I was making from songwriting, I was able to put in the bank because I was playing guitar for Eddie Raven, and I was being paid there. And yep. And then after 9 years with Eddie, I ended up playing guitar for Marie Osmond for 4 years. And then after that, I was in the duo Baker and Meyers for about 4 years.
How was working with Marie Osmond?
It was great. She's awesome. The family is awesome. And first class all the way. And she's everything you would think she is.
Oh, wow. That's pretty cool. Well, tell me, let's get to Eddie Raven, because after you and I Got Mexico. Why don't you play a little bit of I Got Mexico for us?
Okay.
Let me grab my guitar.
I think this is with Eddie Raven, number one. And for a lot Eddie of our Raven's. Listeners, maybe this goes back Eddie. To 84. And so for those of you in the audience, I was a senior in high school, freshman in college. So let's put this together here.
So this was Eddie Raven's first number one record as an artist.
Yep.
I just got tired of that same old job, tired of fighting that freeway mob. I bet you never thought I'd really go, I'd never get as far as Mexico. But I've even learned to speak the language some, down the beach drinking coke and rum. You wouldn't know me with this golden glow, soaking sun in Mexico. I'm eating right and I'm living good, I'm doing everything I said I would. I should have left a long time ago, he's got you, I got Mexico.
Oh my God, that's so good, Frank. I mean, amazing, brother.
Thank you.
And this is why I do what I do. It's why I love having y'all on. It's why I love doing this, is because when you started playing, you started singing right there, my mind went back to 100 yards from where I'm sitting right now, to where my mom and I grew up, and, you know, being a senior in high school, hearing that on the radio, and my mind went back to all of those, you know, thoughts at that point.
Awesome.
That is just so cool. Does it still get you to think, like, you know, for myself, or you hear people, I know because you play rounds, you play, when people talk about a song and what that means to them?
You know what, that means more to me than anything, is the power of the song is, it's just really unbelievable, the power of a song, especially with some of the songs like I was blessed with, like I'm Already There and I Swear, and you know, so many people have told me, you know, that was our wedding song. That was, you know, I sent that song to my dad, or, you know, the stories are just really cool. And, you know, the money is good, you know, when you go out and do these things, but truthfully, having the people come up to you and tell you what one of the songs that you wrote meant to them and how it affected their lives, you know, you can't buy that.
No, you can't. You had some more hits with Eddie Raven. You also worked with you know, that small little group. They, you know, they tried Alabama, you know, they worked in there. Yeah. But 10 years later, you had probably, I would assume, you know, maybe not from your perspective, but probably one of your most awarded hits. You're one of the one that a lot of people know, and that is I Swear, John Michael Montgomery. talk before you play it, talk to us a little bit about that song. And because, like I said, that's one of those I could see having played at special moments, though, that kind of thing. Talk to us about that.
Well, I Swear I was written about 6 years before it got cut.
Oh, wow. You know,
Gary Baker lives, my partner at the time, lives in Sheffield, Alabama, and has been there for many, many years. He actually moved there. He's from Niagara Falls, moved to Texas to play for a while. And I think he met Lenny LeBlanc down there. And anyway, Lenny lived in Muscle Shoals and brought him there to be the bass player for LeBlanc and Carr. So he did that. And then anyway, so I'm about 3 hours away from where I live to where he lives. And he called me one morning and said, "Frank, I have a title I want you to think about on the way down. And it's called I Swear." You know, it's a love song. It's like, I swear I'll love you forever. I swear I'll always be there, that kind of thing. And that's basically all he gave me. And on that 3 hour drive down there, I wrote the chorus to it. And, you know, later that day, in Fame Studios there, we wrote the rest of the song. And then we did a demo on it, or he did a demo down there in the Shoals. Everybody in town passed on it. All the big names at the time. And it was about, so we wrote this in about, I got 85, 86, somewhere in there. And then we started working together. I actually got him the job playing bass in Marie Osmond's band.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. So the keyboard player and her musical conductor, Jerry Williams, God rest his soul, he just passed away at the end of the year.
Oh, wow.
Good friend, a musical genius. Anyway, we were playing him some songs, and he played us some songs and of some tracks that he did for other people and stuff. And we got to I Swear, and he really liked the song. And I said, "You know what? I've never really liked this demo. Why don't you see if you can do a track for us?" And so he came up and with a track and sent it to us. And I put the guitars on, and Gary put the bass on and sang it, and I sang backgrounds. And that was the demo that I played for John Michael Montgomery that got the song cut. And yep. I actually played it three times for John Michael before he finally cut it.
Oh, wow.
You know, it ended up being the very last song that they cut when they were recording the Kicking It Up record. And the last song they cut and first single from the batch. Of course, it was that, a four-week
number one. How many times do you hear that? You know, that it's the last song. We got it in right at the right time. Well, play us a little bit, and then I want to talk more about it.
Okay. Let me, I just need to push this microphone back a little bit.
I see the questions in your eyes. I know what's weighing on your mind. You can be sure I know my part, 'cause I'll stand beside you through the years. You'll only cry those happy tears. And though I'll make mistakes, I'll never break your heart. I swear by the moon and the stars in the sky, I'll be there. I swear, like a shadow that's by your side, I'll be there. For better or worse, till death do us part, I'll love you with every beat of my heart, I swear.
That amazing. I mean, fabulous. I mean, it just, again, another one that brings back so many memories. But there's a little bit of twist to this one, and I'd love to get your take on this, because not only was it a huge hit for John Michael Montgomery, the awards, everything else, this song was also a number one by another group that picked up your version of it, did a cover of All for One version. Did you have much, and this is a curious question for me and for songwriters out there, I guess, they took what you wrote and they changed a little bit of it. How does that work from you owning, you know, the songs and everything? And then them, did they call you and say, hey, we want to record this? Tell us how that worked.
Well, first of all, you know, they licensed the song and it's still our song, whoever wants to do it. But so John Michael was on Atlantic Records, and Atlantic Records called head honcho down here, Rick Blackburn at the time, and asked him, you know, would he consider taking John Michael's version AC? And he said, no, I don't want to, you know, I don't want to tick off country radio. And he said, well, we got a new group up here called All for One. And David Foster is producing a couple sides on them, and they want to do this song. So that's how it happened. They just cut it, and David Foster produced it, did an awesome job. And I didn't even know it was cut until it was actually coming out.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they the head of A&R at the time, Al Cooley over at Atlantic, called me up and asked if Baker was in town. I said he was, and we went over there, and he sat us down, and he said, check this out. And he put the CD in, and I went, I swear.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, my first thought, just because it was just like so high, I thought someone had made a parody of the song at first.
Oh, no. Yeah. I could see it.
But it was so great, and it just kept getting better. And at the end of the song, Rick Blackburn walked in. He said, that's a new group on Atlantic Records in New York called All for One. And David Foster produced that on them. And yes, it's going to be a single. And yes, it's going to go number one. And yes, it's going to win a Grammy. And
yep.
Everything he said came true. And it was an 11-week number one on the pop.
Yes.
And I mean, truthfully, it was number one around the world.
Oh, yeah. It was pretty much. Well, and the interesting part about that, though, think about this for just a second, Frank. That song, you know, from a country perspective, was amazing. You know, John Michael did it. Y'all did it. It's great. It would have had its influence. But by that same token, taking it AC, taking it adult contemporary, taking it with a new, higher version, because there are probably some people listening to this podcast today that remember the All for One version as opposed to the John Michael Montgomery version.
Oh, absolutely.
And so it just I mean, that, imagine the multiplying effect of that, those two groups. And it goes to what is the power of a song, the power of lyrics, the power of that moment, that you can have two differently, completely different genres singing it, and it still touches lives in a huge way.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I said earlier. The power of a song is unbelievable. And a great song doesn't care who sings it either. I mean, it's the difference in the song is really the production at, you know, at the end of the day, unless it's, you know, lyric specific to a certain genre, you know, lots of people can cut it.
Well, that is amazing. And like I said, again, it's really cool to know, you know, and listen to you talk about it, and you're so humble talking about it. But I mean, these are the, you know, these, like I said, you said, you know, people play them at weddings. They play them at, you know, different times in their life. This is I've always spoke about it when I talk about music and what songwriting and music means to me. It's taking what's, you know, in your heart, and it goes through your mind, and it comes through, you know, back out into your hands, and it's written for, you know, down for ages. It's almost like the songwriting to me is like the farmer who's planting, who's in his 70s, who's planting a new row of apple trees. He'll never probably see the apple trees bear fruit, but those somebody else will. And your songwriting is just amazingly, you know, and that it touches, you do that. And you've had the privilege of having songs, you know, like that. I think that's just an amazing kind of time. I want to, a couple of your songs though really touch me, and I want to move ahead. And it seems like you do all these great songs, and you do a lot more in the middle, and then we come up again another round for me. And you started working with a band called Lone Star, and two of the songs that I want to talk about with Lone Star are "I'm Already There" and "My Front Porch Looking In," and. For a minute here, just sort of, let's take the first one, "I'm Already There." Talk to me about that song. What was sort of the impetus behind it? Because I'm going to tell a little bit about, you know, myself a little bit about that song and really the next one as well.
Okay. Well, you know, it's a true song. You know, I knew Richie McDonald before he ever was in Lone Star. I met him in Texas when I was playing with Eddie Raven. Actually, I met all of Lone Star in Texas when they were in different bands, and then they came here and formed Lone Star. But so Gary and I were writing, going to write with Richie, and we showed up one of the PROs in town, and Gary wasn't there. It was just Richie and I, and we were sitting there talking and having coffee, and it was a Monday, and we had just come off the road, both of us, as you know, Lone Star came off the road, and Gary and I as Baker and Meyers. We were just shooting the breeze, and then you know we just started throwing some titles back and forth as to what we might want to write that day, and nothing was hitting me, nothing was hitting him. And Richie just went over to the piano and started the beginnings of this song, and I said, "Richie, what's that?" He said, "Oh," I said, "I wasn't going to play it for you. I thought it might be too personal." And he said, "I called home and I talked to Lori and the kids, and you know, Rhett got on the phone, and he was about 3, or I guess back then. And he said, "Daddy, when you coming home?" And he said, "I got off the phone and cried like a baby and started this." And I said, "Well, I think it's awesome, man. This is what we're going to write today." So we ended up writing the song, and you know, and for people who travel all the time and miss things with their families and miss baseball games or whatever it is, you know, truck drivers, just anybody that travels for a living, could relate to this. And, it became a 7-week number one song for Lone Star. And then the coolest thing happened, the military adopted it, and we have binders 3 inches thick of, emails from military families about how the song touched their life.
Yep. Well, and also the song, you know, timing, it came out a little bit before it, but I know there's a lot of things written about it. And as I was doing my research and looking up stuff, it also became associated with 9/11 as well, you know, with the, you know, this idea of everything going on. This one is special for me. And along with the next one we're going to talk about now, that's that Front Porch Looking In. It's sort of like two songs that say a very similar thing for those of us in life who travel a lot. And you mentioned that just a minute, whether you're a truck driver, whether you're on the road, you're a politician, you're a salesman, you're a songwriter, whatever. And, you know, there's times that you know, you're on the road and you miss a baseball game, you miss something going on. And you know, and that thought that, you know, I'm hearing you in the background and I'm alone in a hotel room somewhere, which, you know, but I'm already there. I want to be there. And then is that more personal melancholy, as you said. And then you got the transition to the Front Porch Looking In, which is I'm home, I'm looking at it, and this is, you know, this is my world. You know, everybody thinks that the world is looking out, but the world is actually looking in. So amazing, you know, look there. So let's do this. Why don't you do back to back? Why don't you go from I'm already there, then transition it in and to my Front Porch Looking In, and then let's talk some more about it. And if I don't cry, you know, we'll be doing pretty good here.
He called her on the road from a lonely cold hotel room just to hear her say, "I love you one more time." And when he heard the sound of the kids laughing in the background, he had to wipe away a tear from his eye. Little voice came on the phone, said, "Daddy, when you coming home?" He said the first thing that came to his mind, "I'm already there. Take a look around. I'm the sunshine in your hair. I'm the shadow on the ground. I'm the whisper in the wind. I'm your imaginary friend. I know I'm in your prayers. Oh, I'm already there." Yeah, yeah. The only ground I ever owned was sticking to my shoes. Now I look out my front porch at this panoramic view. I can sit and watch the fields fill up with rays of golden sun, or watch the moon lay on the fences like that's where it was hung. But my blessings aren't about me, it's all about the man. I never keep the view from my front porch looking in. There's a carrot top that can barely walk with a sippy cup of milk. A little blue-eyed blonde, the shoes on wrong, cause she liked to dress herself. And the most beautiful girl, holding both of them. Yeah, the view I love the most is my front porch looking in.
Wow, wow. I mean... Yeah, I'm sitting here with tears in my eyes. Yes, that was it was there because I can remember being gone and hearing these songs, and they just come back. For me, and I hope you sort of saw my contrast there, and I hope the listener of the podcast, two songs basically saying very similar things, but in two very different styles, in two very, you know, ballad, melancholy, one upbeat, you know, did you ever contrast those two in your head, or were they just written at separate times? I mean,
No, they were written at separate times. I mean, I'm Already There was about actually being gone on the road, right, calling home and missing the family. And then the other one is obviously Richie and I and Don Firmer, the co-writer, God rest his soul, he's gone now. He was strictly a lyricist, and he couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, and he couldn't play an instrument. But he was a great lyricist, and we were up on Richie's big old wraparound porch looking at this beautiful view of his home. It was the first time that we had been there, and the kids were inside playing and had this big old picture window, and Don loved kids, and he was watching the kids, yep, and he was laughing at them and cutting up with them, and Richie and I were just kind of staring off at this beautiful view, and I'm saying, Richie, this is such a beautiful view. There's got to be a We got to find us a hit song idea off his front porch. I know there's one. The view is awesome. And Don just said, well, it ain't as good as the view looking in. And when he said that, we all looked at each other and realized we had something to write about.
That is so true. And you know, and this is really interesting for those of us who travel a lot. In fact, it's really taping this podcast today. I just got off a plane. Fortunately, my wife was traveling with me. Most of the time she doesn't. And, you know, I just come in from getting off the plane, been gone for a few days, and, you know, my kids are now grown for the most part, and one of them came in about 10 minutes before you and I started taping this podcast, and just the thoughts and the feelings that came back when my favorite view is, you know, here. I mean, I can go all over the world and be talked about everywhere, but this is my favorite view.
Absolutely.
You know, it's such a perspective for folks, Frank, and I think and songs, for me, they help us remember that.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, and I tell young songwriters when they ask for advice, of course, I give them advice on different things. But one of the main things I tell them is write from the heart to the heart.
Yep.
From the heart to the heart. And write about things you can relate to. Write about real things and things that people can relate to. You know, when you start writing about all the things you really don't know, it comes out. It shows.
Yeah, so, it does. Well, and your writing is again, with so many songs, you know, for us to cover. I wanted to cover, you know, some songs. One, it had a lot of meaning to me, but also, you know, as you just said, you write about things, you know, I podcast and talk about from, it's coming real authentic for me, that songs that impacted and touched me. And I think that is what is important. You've now written across 4 decades. Okay, easily 4 decades, not counting your prior time in 5 decades and 6 decades. What do you see out there for the, and it maybe comes back to that authenticity question you just answered. What's kept you, if you were telling a young songwriter now in today's environment, because it seems like we're always changing, you know, what's hot and what's not, and they're having to chase, unfortunately, more of that one-time wonder than they are the bigger message of album cuts and things that you know, first came into. Is it just be authentic, be who you are, and the song will find itself. Is that sort of the a thought you would give to somebody starting out or in the middle of maybe even a rut right now?
Well, you know, I think it depends on the situation of the writer. You know, the writer may be signed to, let's just say, you know, Florida Georgia Line. Of course, they're broke up now, but they started a publishing company and they had some writers and, right, and programmers, and they were writing stuff for them, you know?
Right.
So they kind of had the people they were going to write for. I just always tell songwriters, you know, write something that's going to connect with everybody, you know?
Yeah.
Write something that's going to be here when you're no longer here.
You know,
write those evergreen songs that, you know, don't chase what's going on today, because if you start chasing what's happening today, you know, by the time you get there, it's something else. So just try to write the best song you can anytime that you sit down to write, because, you know, you're going to spend however long you're going to spend trying to write a song. You know, you're wasting your time if you don't try to write the best song you can. And I think what helps make a song the best song is by finding the best idea, and it's an idea that you can sink your teeth into and you know, really write about, as opposed to just something fluffy and just fun, which you got to write those songs too. Everybody wants to have fun, but the songs that seem to have the staying power are the ones, again, written from the heart to the heart, connecting with a wide variety of people, and you write it in a way that it doesn't matter what background you're from, what ethnicity or anything else, you know, they connect to it. And they put their own story into it. It's just like you said, you know, with Front Porch Looking In, you know, your place is right there where you are right there. And that's the same for everybody. It's your home. It's your roots. It's, you know, whatever. So when you write songs that, you know, people can relate to, then that's what makes a hit song, and that's what makes a song stay around long after you're gone.
Thanks, Ed. Folks, I can't put any better than that. Frank summed it up. You know, it's like everything else in life. Be authentic, be who you are, and it'll last the lifetime. Frank, you've already touched many, many lives in more ways than, you know, we could ever talk about here and you'll ever know. And I think that's the great part about songwriting that we have. But it has been a blessing and a joy to have you on the Doug Collins Podcast. Thank you so much for sharing your love and wisdom.
It's been my pleasure, and thank you for asking me to come on, and hopefully we can do it again sometime. And
we're looking to actually maybe come up, and I've told Bart about this, and for all the listeners on the podcast, you know, we're looking to maybe time to time. I'm going to go to Nashville. We're going to sit in that old Nashville Songwriters back studio room there, and we're going to get a lot of us ready to talk about this all at a time, and I think it's going to be really cool. You'll definitely be a part of that. Frank, I do appreciate it.
Thank you, buddy. Take care. God bless.
And folks, we'll see you again on the next time on the Doug Collins Podcast. Hey, everybody, you know about Legacy Precious Metals. Legacy Precious Metals, you hear from them. We talk once a month. We talk about Legacy Precious Metals, talking about precious metals being part of your portfolio, how they're your navigator. Well, now they're not only navigating in a new way, they're actually giving you a new way to buy gold and silver. In fact, Legacy Precious Metals has developed a revolutionary new online platform that allows you to invest in real gold and silver online. In a few easy steps, you can open an account online, select your metals of choice, and choose to have them stored in a vault or shipped to your door. I'm more of a ship to my door kind of person. I enjoy having them with me, but they can do it either way, and you can now do it online. It gives you real access to a dashboard where you can track your portfolio growth in real time, anytime. You'll see transparent pricing on each coin and bar. This puts you in complete control of your money. This platform is free to sign up for. Just visit legacypminvestments.com and open your account and see this new investing platform for yourself. Gold hedges against inflation and is against a volatile stock market. A true diversified portfolio isn't just more stocks and bonds, but a different asset class. This platform allows you to make investments in gold and silver, no matter how small or large, with just a few clicks. Remember, do as I have done. Go to legacypminvestments.com and get started today. And now you've got a new tool to help you along in your investments. Hey folks, MyPillow is excited to bring to you their biggest bedding sale ever. For a limited time, you're going to get the Giza Dream bed sheets for as low as $29.98, a set of pillowcases for only $9.98, and rejuvenate your bed with a MyPillow mattress topper for as low as $99.99. $99.99. Get a mattress, pillow topper. Look, they come in all sizes. They got all kinds of stuff. Blankets. They've got duvets. They've got quilts. They got comforters. They got body pillows. They got bolster pillows. They got all at big, big discounts. And also, they're extending their money-back guarantee for Christmas until March 1, 2023, making them the perfect gift for your friends, your family, and for everyone you know. Folks, and just from a personal note here, I have the Giza Dream Sheets. They're on my bed right now. I slept on them last night. Some of the best sheets that we and Lisa and I have ever owned. They are worth, I mean, at this price, they're a steal. My wife and I have bought bed sheets, linens at much higher cost. It's supposedly much higher quality. These from MyPillow are at the highest of quality. And at a price like this, you can't beat it. So go now to MyPillow.com. Use promo code Collins, C-O-L-L-I-N-S, or call 1-800-986-3994. And you'll get huge discounts on all the MyPillow bedding products, including the Giza Dream bed sheets for as low as $29.98, and get all your shopping done while qualities last. And remember, put in that promo code Collins for these discounts.